Happy Wednesday, everyone. Welcome to Paul Walsh Field, the campus of New Bedford High School for Dartmouth baseball. As the Indians host the Durfee Hilltoppers on neutral ground here in New Bedford for Southeast Conference play. Hello again, everybody. Evan Massu joined by Chad Amaral. Great to have you with us live this evening. A chilly one here in New Bedford. The rain kind of messing up plans a little bit, Chad, as UMass Dartmouth and the Corsairs baseball team was supposed to play at home yesterday. The rain, they ended up postponing. It was actually a fairly dry afternoon, as it turned out, but they postponed their game to today, which bumped the high school. So now we're here in a beautiful facility.
Not too bad for Dartmouth. I mean, still playing in another great field in New Bedford. This is probably one of the better fields they'll play on all season. I mean, UMass Dartmouth is fantastic, but this New Bedford field is great. Well maintained. It is. It's going to take to put a ball out of here. It's going to take a shot. It's going to take a. So I mean, advantage pitchers.
Yeah, 370 dead center field, but it's a double fence out there. So you really got to get behind it. And the wind. You can see the flag out there is blowing from right to left as usual, coming over the hill from Rockdale Ave, and blowing right across the outfield. So. Left field has traditionally been a pretty decent jet stream if you get it up there enough, if you get it up in the air enough. So, but Durfee coming in off of a win on this very field on Monday against New Bedford. So they took that one in conference play. That was a big win for them, 3-2. And now here they are back here 2 days later for another road game. Ironically, Monday's game was Durfee's home game against New Bedford because there's – you know, I'm sure many of you know, Durfee's getting new fields, so as a result, not able to play at home right now. Field is not ready, so Durfee boys have not been home once this season. We're going to take a quick pause for the national anthem, and we'll give you some pregame notes on Dartmouth. Dartmouth coming off the first base foul line. Chad and I had the game last Friday, which was at UMass, the Dartmouth rivalry game against Bishop Stang. And Chad, that was a really good game, entertaining game to watch. We saw some clutch hitting, aggressive approaches at the plate. We saw decent pitching from both sides.
And we'll see the same pitcher here tonight, yeah. Luke Aronson. I mean, he kept the Stang batters off balance all game. And I mean, coming into this one, he's looking to do more of the same. And talking with Durfee's coach, he said before the game, the offense is struggling a little bit. They're playing good defense, but right now they need their bats to wake up. So, I mean, Aronson's been strong all season for Dartmouth. He's got three wins, and last time out he dominated Stang.
And then, you know, since Friday, Dartmouth did actually have one other game on Monday as well. They won that one. That was against Brockton. So the Indians coming in now on a four-game winning streak with a 6-3 record. So once they hit 500, they haven't looked back, and they're hoping to keep it going here tonight against the Hilltoppers. The first time both sides have squared off on the season. Recapping Aronson on Friday, his last start. Five innings, four hits, three runs, One earned, one walk, and six Ks. So not a bad day on the mound.
Freight spoke about him after the game. He said he did a great job of getting out of some jams, and he did a great job of mixing his pitches. He wasn't just – he can throw hard, but he also has some good off-speed stuff. He's not a one-trick pony. He definitely can mix in those off-speed stuff to keep the hitters off balance.
And he's got a big presence out there. He's a tall righty. For high school, he's a tall pitcher.
Yeah, he's a football – offensive lineman in football. So, uh-huh. I mean, he's a big guy.
All right.
And a big over-the-top delivery. The ball comes in there pretty hard.
Sure does. And you know, we were – you know, we're a little higher up tonight, but, you know, we really had a good sense at UMass, a little closer to ground level, you know, the movement on the pitches and the command of the zone. He really was, I mean, he pitched to contact. He did have six Ks, you know, in 15 outs, but he put the ball in play. He was around the plate.
He's got a great catcher back there, too, with Donovan Burgo. So, they're quite a battery, those two.
Wrapping up the warm-up pitches here at Paul Walsh Field, we'll run down Durfee's starting lineup. The 4-5 Hilltoppers fresh off their win against New Bedford here on Monday. Leading off, Josh Boria, the center fielder. The starting pitcher, Josh Martell, bats second, followed by Ethan Canberra at second, batting third. In the cleanup spot, Sebastian Reese at third, followed by Alexis Montilla, the right fielder, batting fifth. In the sixth spot, shortstop Jaden Espinal, followed by first baseman Aaron Ferreira. The DH batting eighth, Owen Moniz, followed by Ben Sherry in the number nine spot. Listed as number 10, Caleb Martins, the catcher, but I believe Durfee's only batting nine, so Martins just playing the field this evening. Defensively for the Indians in the infield, Freitas at third, Smith at short, Andrews at second, Lackey at first. In the outfield, Coppola, Fenno, and Cruz left to right. Burgo behind the dish, as you said, Chad catching for Aronson. LeRivière, the DH for Coach Freitas. And Boria, the left-handed batting leadoff man in there, looking at ball one. You know, nice for me to be able to see a Durfee game. Quite honestly, this is my first one because with everything being on the road, it's been extremely challenging this spring. I know it has been for you guys as well, as that is down the left side of the infield and foul. Spring's been challenging for everybody, basically, between, you know, the weather hasn't been that great. You know, and Durfee, like I said, has not been at home. They've had two practices on an actual field.
Yeah, no.
Coach was saying it's horrible. That's, I mean, doesn't make it easy.
No better way for Dartmouth and Durfee to play each other, but in New Bedford. So,
yeah, right.
We got 2-2.
Yeah, that one missing outside. Another tailing fastball sinking down and away to the lefty, and Boria works it even. Infield playing straight up here. Outfield rather shallow. Chopper to the right side. Andrews gathers it on a hop and throws on to first just in time. Boria has good speed. Boria also on the hill as well for Durfee frequently, one of the pitchers as well on this team.
Nice job by Andrews. And when you're dealing with a leadoff hitter, he's obviously on the fast guy. So you don't want to rush too much, but you got to make the throw, and you can't lob it over there. You got to get some power behind that throw.
Josh Martell, the starter for today, looking at a breaking ball for strike one. Swung on and missed quickly, 0-2.
Aronson had some gas on that one. He brought the heat on that one.
Swinging bunt from Martell. Throw to first in time. A strike from Aronson to Lackey, and there's two down.
Nice job by Luke.
Kind of reached up to get it, like almost like a tomahawk swing, you know?
Gathered himself, make a nice throw to first. Don't rush yourself. That's always a tough play for a pitcher because you're coming from an elevated position. Got to walk down the mound, to reset your feet, make the throw to first. Good job by him. looks like an easy play, but it's not that. It's not an easy play for a pitcher.
No, it's not. It's amazing how many pitchers, once they get on the ground to make a play in the field, struggle with that throw.
Oh yeah,
whether they're lefty or righty, it doesn't make a difference.
Because you really have to get your feet under you, turn the shoulder, and make the right throw to first.
Yeah.
You don't want to rush that throw and get an error on an easy out that you want right there.
Sure.
So now he's got the first two guys.
Yep, Ethan Canberra, the second baseman for Durfee, up with two down. The base is empty, looking at a 1-1. That is a strike called low in the zone.
Heard that mitt pop on that one.
Yeah.
Staying ahead of the batters early. That's exactly what he did all last game, especially early on in the game.
Roped into center, a liner right back where it came from, and the Hilltoppers have a two-out base runner. It's the first hit of the night. And Canberra's on first with a ringing single. Stayed back on it. Looked to be like a breaking ball or, you know, a little something off speed. And stayed back just enough to, you know, not get too far ahead of it.
That's the perfect hit right at the middle. Nice job by Canberra.
Sebastian Reese, that ball gets away.
Oh, he's going to third?
He's going to go to third.
Oh,
no. Big wide turn. A lot of room in the backstop here.
Deep backstop here. Durfee checking it early. I'm sure they saw how it played last game when they were here on Monday.
Uh-huh.
Deep backstop, but Burgo's got a strong arm.
Now, amazingly, this backstop, while there is a lot of room, Durfee, before the construction, Durfee's field actually had more space between the fence and home plate. They brought it in.
That's a catcher's nightmare.
Tons of space, like really. As part of the new construction, they actually did bring the fence in a little bit more, so it's a wider fence, and it's not such a point, you know, or an angle. So we'll actually, fans, us broadcasters in Fall River, will be a little closer to the action, which is kind of nice.
3-0, probably a take situation here. He's probably not swinging. If you look at the Durfee hitters, they're way in the back of the batter's box because Aronson's bringing the heat. So you're trying to give yourself as much time. So you're standing in the deep in the batter's box. Give yourself just a half second more or a quarter of a second more.
Ball four. Aronson wanted no part of Reese. Reese has very good power at the dish.
That's probably an intentional, unintentional walk. Like, you get behind him. There's no, you got two outs here.
Sure.
Now you have a force at every base. There's no point in giving him anything to hit.
Yeah, you just, you know, now you really got to worry about the batter and hope Montilla doesn't burn you. But Reese definitely, I would say, the power hitter in the lineup for Durfee. At one point early last season was leading the conference in home runs. So he's a dangerous bat.
I'm sure Aronson's been coached about how to deal with the Reese because he was very careful. He's a good
roped right center field, and the Hilltoppers are going to strike first with a two-out RBI single from Montilla. The walk comes back to bite him. A little two-out magic for Durfee.
Yeah, that ball was crushed.
And he stayed back on that, too. Another one, staying back on the pitch, not getting too far ahead.
Yeah, he ripped it, and, I mean, they had a good read on the pitch, easy to score. Dartmouth did a good job at least keeping the runners at first and second.
Sure. You know, given some of the offensive struggles that Coach Martin was talking about, that's a wild pitch. The runners will go up another 90 feet. That's the second wild pitch of the inning.
Yeah, and that takes away the force at every –
yeah,
at every base. So now you got second and third. He plays at first, but now you have two runners in scoring position. So not ideal. They're doing all their damage with two outs.
Jaden Espinal, the batter, down to the windup goes Aronson with first base open. That one inside part of the plate for a called strike. It's 1-1.
These are the kind of innings we saw towards the end of Aronson's outing the other day. Those high stress innings. These pitches are different for a pitcher than when the bases are empty. These are high-stress pitches.
Yeah.
These, you're trying to throw fast. You're careful with every pitch. So, I mean, this is – you want to avoid these as much as you can. These pitches almost count as two for a pitcher.
Yeah.
They'll tire you out at the end of the game.
3-1. And Espinal ahead in the count. You know, I was about to say, you know, what Coach Martin's telling us, you know, some of the offensive struggles for Durfee. To strike first with two out like this after two quick outs – sliced up the line foul, and the count will be full. You know, for Durfee to get a run across with two down, nice little rally and spot Martel, you know, with at least a one-run lead before he even hits the mound, it's got to feel good.
Oh, it's huge. And this is a big pitch right here because you're going to have the runners are running. And
snagged nice in the air by Aronson to end the inning. I thought that was by him. What a play.
Well, he was just defending himself there.
Yeah, but it worked.
It's catch it or be hit. So good job by Aronson.
Talk about reaction time. That was the pitch previous.
That's a scary play for a pitcher.
Sure is.
He got the out and everything worked out, but that's a nightmare because that was smoked right up the middle.
It was. That would have been two more runs.
Let's see it here. Ooh, nice job by Aaron.
That's awesome. Love it.
He just stuck that glove out there.
Well,
good job by him. That saved two runs.
It saved two runs.
He doesn't catch that. That's going up the middle, and two runs are scoring, and we're dealing with a 3-0 game and with a guy on first. So big play, big catch by Aronson.
That could be a factor in this game when it's all said and done. You never know. But that's a great play there from Aronson. As you said, took two runs off, but Durfee does get themselves a 1-0 lead to work with here as Martel is warming up now for the Hilltoppers on the mound. Take a look at Dartmouth's lineup while Martel is out there. Center fielder Chase Fennell leading it off, as he usually does, followed by shortstop Aiden Smith. Chase Lackey at first, bats third, followed by Aiden Cruz, the right fielder, in the cleanup spot. Donovan Burgo, the catcher, bats fifth, followed by Ryan Coppola in left field. Matt LaRiviere, the DH, bats seventh, with Louis Freitas at third in the eighth spot. And rounding things out, Marcus Andrews, the second baseman, bats ninth for the Indians. Durfee's defense behind Martel. Reese at third, Espinal at short, Canberra at second, Ferreira at first, and in the outfield left to right, Sherry Boria and Montilla. Martins behind the plate catching Martel, and Fenno will step into the box for the first time tonight.
Today's starting pitcher for the Hilltoppers is number 2, Josh Martel. And the leadoff batter for Dartmouth is number 1, Chase.
Thought I was done with the the puffer jacket here, but nope, had to break it out.
That's a very puffy jacket. That's a December jacket.
Yeah, but you know what?
It's not. I'm
it was warmer in December. It says 53 degrees. It's not. It's quite chilly here.
Well, you look like it's like 5 degrees, but
that's all right. After last Friday, ripped to left. Oh, to center, rather, excuse me. And right at Boria, who catches it, coming in on it. Thought he hooked it a little more than that. First out.
We saw that the other day. They don't, especially early on, they attack. They're not waiting deep in counts. When they're feeling out this pitcher, they're going to go after him early.
Yeah, that was a frozen rope right at Boria. For out number 1, that brings up Smith.
Unfortunately, just hit it right at the outfielder.
Yeah. No, I was going to say that after Friday with the wind whipping right at us at UMass, I said, I'm bringing extra layers, and I don't care. Because, you can always take the layers off a little bit, but if you get warm. But, man, it's definitely chilly.
Yeah, I'm okay. It's cold. It's cold. It's not.
It's not hockey. It's not Hetland or Driscoll, that's for sure, when you go outside in December to warm up. Inside for 3-0 count to Smith. Martel asking where that pitch was. Pretty clear that it was down and in. It was not near the plate.
No, that wasn't a strike.
No, not at all. So 3-0. That's a strike. Good pitch. Right on the outside part of the plate. Tailing fastball, grabbing that corner. And it's 3-1. Upstairs, ball 4. And Smith on base for the Indians with one down.
Yeah, for the Indians, now you got some speed on the base paths. and the meat of your lineup coming up. I mean, we saw the other day with Chase Lackey, he even dropped a bunt.
I know, right?
he had a bunt single. I mean, he's a three-hitter.
Whatever it takes, you know, a run is a run is a run. And Lackey steps in on the left side. Takes a first pitch strike. I haven't been here since Thanksgiving morning, since football. Durfee in New Bedford. Close play at first on the pickoff.
Won that game.
New Bedford won that game. Good lead there.
Aiden, yeah, plenty of time. He's got the oven mitt on. Nice dive.
Yeah.
They know he's got some speed, so they're going to... Oh, that was...
Little excuse me swing. Throw to first to try to double him up. It's actually off the runner.
Yeah.
So no double off there, but Lackey half-hearted swing like he didn't really end up wanting to swing at it.
Yeah, that'll drive a coach crazy because, I mean, you either got to commit to your swing or don't swing. That half swing almost got him doubled up.
Yeah.
Aiden at first. That's...
Another check on the runner and another close play there at first base. So two down here in the first, and the cleanup hitter Cruz stepping in with Smith at first base. See if he takes off. He really has a good lead and a good secondary lead he's getting as well. So
giving him a lot of attention. I mean, it's first inning. I mean, they probably don't need to. I would worry about the batter right now if I'm them. You got two outs.
Sure.
I don't think Aiden.
Let him take second if he wants it.
There's really. We saw the other day catchers being overzealous, making bad throws. End up costing Stang. So, I mean, you're better off. If you're a pitcher, just worry about the batter. You got two outs.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. The pitch down low. Good place to miss. 2-0 the count. Martel gave a look over to first again, stepped off the rubber, now gets the sign.
I'll tell you, there would have been a pitch clock violation already.
Roped into left field. That'll be in for a two-out hit right in front of Sherry. And up to second base goes Smith. So first hit of the night for the Indians. And they got something brewing with two down.
Nice job there by Aiden Cruz, pulling the ball to the left. But that's what I mean, just worry about the batter in that situation. Don't worry about that. Now Aiden Smith's on second. He's on first. Mm-hmm. Batter should be your first priority right now. Now Dartmouth with their first chance here. One runner in scoring position. You got Burgo up. Burgo had a big day the other day when we were at the game.
A sneaky, powerful swing, like easy swing like John Olerud, and he sent it deep to right field. Couldn't believe how far the ball carried.
And he had been slumping, and coach brought him up in the lineup. He was the nine hitter the other day, and now he's back up in the five spot.
Yeah, if he connects, if he makes contact, it's going to go a long way. Down to the count 0-1. Calling for a balk.
Yeah, they were looking.
We saw that on Friday too, actually. Yeah, if you did.
Aiden Smith doing a good job of getting into their head. I mean, he's playing games with them over there. If anything, just taking a little distraction.
Yeah.
He's kind of being a pest over there, which is good for him.
With the runner at second, playing off the line is Ferreira. So there is some space there. If Burgo gets ahead of one and pulls it, there's some room on the line, the first base line.
There's
quite a bit of room, actually. That's a little bit uncharacteristic, especially with a lefty at the plate. 2-1 count to Burgo. Inside, gets jammed. Slow roll to Canberra.
Good pitch.
The throw to first. Bang, bang play, but it is in time. They did jam him, and you're right. good pitch right there. So the Indians held scoreless as Martel works around a one-out walk and a two-out single. 1-0 Durfee after one.
Toppers, number 16, Aaron Ferrara.
Top of the second, Aronson dealing to the bottom third of Durfee's order. Aaron Ferrara, the first baseman, leading things off.
Nice job by Aronson, getting ahead in the count. Well, that didn't last long, but 1-1. Work in the outside corner over here.
Driven in the air, left field, opposite field, tailing, foul, and out of play.
Yeah, you got the shadows are coming over the field, but it looks like the sun was a factor in left because it didn't look like he had it right away off the bat.
Big time.
He's got the sunglasses on out there.
Outside, 3-1.
3-2.
3-2, thank you. So a full count. That one inside.
Lost him there.
Lost him. Almost hit him, in fact, as well. So leadoff man on for the Hilltoppers via the walk. That's the third walk of the game we've seen. Second for Aronson.
Now batting number 9, Owen Moniz.
Yeah, it's his second walk so far. Command is key for him.
And now the number 8 batter, Owen Moniz.
No, it's Moniz.
Inside for strike 1. It's 1-1, grabbing that corner. That's right, we had this debate. I know we're in New Bedford, but it's a Fall River kid. So Moniz, Moniz.
Yeah, but we're also
tomato, tomato.
Dartmouth Community Media. So, yeah, we'll
go. Here we go again.
We'll go with Moniz.
Dan, where were you on Friday? We already fought about this. Talking to the truck. That's funny. Another thing to heighten the Fall River New Bedford rivalry, that's all. How do we say Moniz or Moniz?
Dartmouth's in the middle. We're the tiebreaker. It's Moniz. Ooh, we got
1-6-3, double play.
We gave it to him. Close play. Nice play.
Beautiful play. And I think the throw was there. It's the right call by the ump. turned that beautifully, and it started with Aronson.
Out of the chute, I thought he was going to beat it out, but it was great, great dig by Chase Lackey over there on this, the one hop. Very nice. Big play by Dartmouth. That's erases the banner.
And a fly ball to left ends the inning. So Aronson ends up facing the minimum after the leadoff walk, and it was a quick top of the second inning. 6, 7, and 8 coming up for Dartmouth in the bottom half.
Nice job by Aronson. He's pitching to contact, but he's got defense helping him there. He's helped himself a lot.
Sure.
It's turned by him on the double play.
But this is just like last Friday. Same situation. Around the plate with command. Not afraid to put it in play. The fielders did a good job Friday. Good start here tonight for Dartmouth.
Yeah, Aronson's pitching with a lot of confidence. I mean, so Dartmouth, now you're down 1-0. You got to get going on offense, and it's still early, but we got Ryan Coppola coming up. You say I'm Coppola, but I say Coppola.
That's right. Welcome to the booth, everybody.
It's nice to be in a booth. Usually we're just on the bench.
Now this guy, you know, let him on the air, stealing my lines. I haven't done a game in a booth for baseball, probably since I interned for the Bay Sox here 13 years ago. Oh my gosh. Great view. Great view here. So.
Oh yeah, we're here. No, who needs the Celtics, you know? Probably.
Oh God, here we go. I don't even want to talk about professional sports after the weekend we just had. So, Ryan Coppola, or Coppola, as you said.
For Dartmouth, number 21, Ryan Coppola.
Oh, we got affirmation that it's
chopper to the left side, deep short for Espinal. He's got a strong arm. Throw to first, not in time. Pulled him off the bag. That's great effort.
That's a tough play.
It really is.
Deep in the hole. Nice job. Even make that a close play.
Espinal has a. He did this all last year. He's got a really good arm out there, but.
He did everything right. I mean, there's not many high schoolers are making that throw. That was nice. He did everything perfect on that.
We had a shortstop in Fall River at Diamond early on when I started, going back like 2013-ish, maybe 2014, Austin Crowninshield. He also was a QB for football. This kid had a cannon. I mean, sure, even further into left field, and he gunned down a guy at first. Like, unbelievable, the arm that he had at short. Some of the plays he made, like, made you think of, like, Nomar or Jeter, like, those types of plays. It was really quite impressive. In the air, left field, a shallow pop fly. Sherry under it, and he squeezes the glove on it for out number one. So, LeRivière retired, the DH, down after the fly ball out.
Yeah, easy fly ball. Dartmouth. Last inning, they made some noise with two outs. Going to have to do the same this inning. You got Louis Freitas and Mark Andrews coming up. So, bottom of the order, trying to turn over the order to get the top of the order up by next inning.
Freitas, the third baseman, batting now with Coppola at first. Taking off.
Delayed steal.
Durfee napping defensively.
Yeah, you could see there.
Not good there. That's a mental breakdown.
Well, Coppola, it was a delayed steal. He tested it, and then he was gone. He didn't even draw a throw. I mean, before he even threw the pitch, he was halfway there.
Yeah. No, exactly.
Easy steal. Get the runner in scoring position. Now a weak single can drive him in.
Freitas swings through it. 1-1 now the count. Andrews on deck. Big hole on the right side of the infield, almost the whole right side of the infield, because Canberra's holding on the runner now at second. So if Freitas can protect here with now two strikes and he kind of slaps at it the other way, he's got an easy single on the ground.
And you got one out. I mean, you could even bunt here. I mean, the bunt. The
you
bunt,
could.
The bunt is wide open. It's if you want to get the runner at third.
I mean, less likely with two strikes now, but
yeah.
Even so, ooh, framed by Martin's close pitch to take. It's 2-2. I mean, I can't remember, though. I mean, basically, you have Canberra almost playing dead in line with second and home base. Like, he's so far over.
Yeah, they're
but conceding the right side of the infield.
They're holding that runner.
Yeah. 2-2 is down and away in the dirt, and it's a full count.
Dartmouth being aggressive on the base paths. You know, they're probably expecting a close game. Coach Freitas knows he's going to... If it's going to be close, every run matters. Sometimes you got to force base runners to get the other team uncomfortable.
Just getting a piece of it fouled to the backstop.
Full count. Big pitch right here.
Three-two pitch again from Martel to Freitas. Got him swinging.
Got him. Nice pitch.
Up in the zone, they elevated with the heat. It's the first strikeout of the night for either pitcher, and there is two down here in the second.
He brought it with that one. High fastball. Freitas gave it a hack, but he couldn't catch up to it.
Marcus Andrews, the number nine batter, stepping in now with two down, and Coppola in scoring position with good speed. Tying run here in the early goings. 1-0 Durfee. That's in there for a strike.
A nice off-speed pitch right there. Kind of buckled his knees a little bit.
This Durfee team had a really strong season last year. Better finish than they started. Ended up going three rounds in the playoffs, losing to BR, a tight game at BR, but that was after a win at home in the first round and then a win up at North Andover in the second round before losing to the Trojans. So really, they were a strong team last year, a little bit of a slower start this year, but, you know, again, some challenges along the way as well. 0-2 is sent to right. Montilla backpedaling a bit, settles under it for the third out, and Martel strands another base runner as the Hilltoppers continue to hold the 1-0 lead through two.
That out. We have reached the end of the second inning. The score is...
Welcome back to Paul Walsh Field in New Bedford. At New Bedford High School, home of the Dartmouth Indians this evening. Evan Massoud and Chad Amaral with you for live baseball. The Indians hosting the Durfee Hilltoppers for a conference play. 1-0 Hilltoppers through two. Top of the order for the second time. Boria stepping in against Aronson. Boria grounded to second to start off the ball game.
So their second look at Aronson. So this is a pitcher. They've seen you now. So now the advantage kind of goes to the hitters. First time around, you have the advantage. They haven't seen you. Second time around, they know how they've seen the off speed. They've seen the fastball. So now you got to be more creative.
Both pitchers working quickly, dealing with base runners in both innings. It was a 6:30 game. It's just after 7 o'clock now, so good pace of play. We'll be seeing the lights on soon as the sun is now dipped behind the hill. 2-1 hitters count for Boria, and he swings and fouls it off at the plate.
Evens up the count. Got a little bit of a crowd here. People are bundled up. Some people probably home watching it on DC TV and watching the Celtics on the other TV. So
that's right. That's lifted to the gap in left center. Oh, that's going to go.
He lost it in the sun.
He did.
His first step was
out at second base.
He threw him out. Unbelievable. Nice throw.
You know, Coppola cut that off a lot faster than I thought he was going to, number one. And number two, one heck of a throw because Boria can move. So out at second, trying to stretch it into a double.
I'll tell you.
What a throw.
What a great way to make up. Because he probably should have caught that.
Yeah.
He read it completely wrong. And then he comes up and throws him out at second. So you're immediately forgiven for your mistake. That's nice job.
So it's a 7-4 put out after the single. So Boria gets credited with the single and then has to take the walk of shame after getting thrown out at second base.
There's no shame in that one. That was a great throw. I'll tell you, you're going to send him every time on that. It was
popped up. Aronson wants it. Called off now by Lackey, who makes the catch quickly. Two down here in the third.
Nice job by Lackey taking control here, calling off the pitcher. Easier play for him.
So Martel in the ISO there, just swinging, you know, kind of leaning back, reaching up for the ball. Ball was a bit up in the zone and couldn't get on top of it, hence the pop-up. And so he's retired. Canberra, the batter, he singled and scored in the first, the lone run of the ball game so far. And he looks at strike one. Aronson faced the minimum last inning after a leadoff walk. In position for the same this inning after a leadoff single, and it's quickly 0-2 to Canberra.
Yeah, the Dartmouth defense has been strong. I mean, Aronson got out of that last inning with that liner right up the middle, and for Coppola to make that play there, that was enormous. Coppola, sorry.
Tomato, tomato. 1-2, good waste pitch there. Way up in the zone for Aronson, still in command. On the ground, 2-2, the grass slowing it up a bit, but he's going to beat it out at first. Wow. Canberra,
the Hilltoppers
put on the zoomies.
The Hilltoppers first base coach. He was jumping up and down in that one.
Yeah.
Good.
No, that's good hustle there from the right batter's box. Canberra with the zoomies down the first base line. He can book it.
I mean, I'll tell you, every coach loves seeing that because they always tell you, bust out of the batter's box. You never know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And he proved that point right there. If you're a coach, and judging by the first base coach's reaction, he absolutely loved it. So perfect. Nice job by Canberra. You got you got on base strictly on hustle on that one because that was a routine play.
Well, Alex Benavides, one of the assistant coaches for Durfee, he's the one at first base tonight. His brother and I actually graduated together in 07 from Durfee, so I've known Alex a long time, and he is as much of a fan as he was a player, so particularly for baseball. So not surprised to see him jumping up and down there. So
I mean, I'm sure he ingrains that in him all week. Hustle out of the box. Don't look at the pitch. And then his guy did it at a big moment. He's on base because of it.
Snap throw to first. Not in time. And it's 0-2 to Sebastian Reese, who walked and was left at third in the first.
He walked on four pitches last at bat.
Mm-hmm. Chopper to the right side again. More routine for Andrews. Not as much speed for Reese. And the side is retired.
Nice play by Andrews. It's always tough. When you're in high school, you play in all these different fields. Some fields have an infield grass. Some infields do not have an infield grass. Here, you see the ball get hit by Reese, that last hop dies.
Yeah.
It just completely dies. So Andrews does a good job staying back on it, making the right play.
The grass, I mean, we were down there pregame, and the grass is like a carpet. It's super thick, but it's manicured well. I can't get over how good these fields are. Whenever we come here, whether it's football, whether it's here baseball, I mean, I kid, but it's the truth. Thanksgiving morning, you know, show up for football last November, and that field looked like it was in the middle of summer in terms of the quality and the green and the thickness of the grass. And
well, field,
it's awesome.
And these fields play differently. When you're playing baseball in New England, in this time of year, the infield grass is the ball's gonna die.
Yeah,
you start playing baseball in June and July, that ball may as well be turf. It's gonna fly right off of it.
It's drier.
It's drier. It's harder. So right now, it's as an infielder, you got to know that. I'm sure the coach preaches it to him when it's coming off the grass. You're gonna have to be a little more aggressive. You can't just stay back on the ball every time. And it's gonna take a different hop. It's not gonna take the same hard hop off of it.
And that's exactly why Canberra beat that out. I mean, Canberra's got speed, but that ball, after it got past the mound, it just died.
Yeah.
Like, Andrews was, like, waiting for it.
Yeah.
And it took forever to get to him. Indians ready to bat here in the bottom of the third against Martell. Chase Fennell, the leadoff batter. So Dartmouth turning the card over now as well here in the bottom half of the third. So back to the top of the order. Fennell flew out to center to start the game. Now a ringing liner right back where it came from on the first pitch.
Fenno's seen two pitches today. He has a single and a flyout. Both hits, the flyout to center and a single to center.
That was a liner right over the head of Martell.
Fenno is not waiting. He's aggressive at the plate. Here he just rips it to center field. Last time he hit a line drive that was caught, but Fenno is very aggressive up there.
So leadoff batter on for the second straight inning for Dartmouth. Last inning, Coppola got on with an infield single. Here, Fenno with the single up the middle, and it brings up Aiden Smith, who walked in his first plate appearance. Check on the runner at first. I think Martell's pickoff move is really solid. It's quick to first.
Especially for a right-handed pitcher, it's a lot harder as a righty. I mean, a lefty has a big advantage trying to pick runners off. But for a righty, he does have a good move. But he's gone.
He's gone. Ball was in the dirt. And Martin's...
They definitely have something on him, though. He doesn't have a... He's not slow to the plate. He's not slow to the plate, but they are being extra aggressive on the base paths.
Yeah.
I mean, he had a great jump on that. Fenno... I mean, he drew a throw, but there was no...
Honestly,
there.
I would have eaten the throw because your chance, what if it goes into center now? You know you're not going to get him. So I would have held it.
It wasn't close. Yeah, wasn't close.
1-1 count to Smith with the runner at second now, and it is a low strike called. Smith doesn't like the call.
He doesn't like it, and he kind of tried to shrink himself.
Yeah.
Like he bent down trying to shrink his strike zone, but it was a strike.
So 1-2 now, Martell ahead in the count. Working through the top of the order here. That one on the ground, 2-2. Moon almost full, peeking through the clouds now as it's getting high in the sky over left center.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure these outfielders who have that weird sun in left field right now can't wait for the sun to go away.
I know.
Maybe a little colder, but when you're an outfielder, it's a big difference to get that sun away.
That's upstairs. Full count now to Smith. Had been 1-2, but one in the dirt and one up in the zone has run it to 3-2. Just getting a piece. Brought the heat inside and jammed him.
Hanging in there. I mean, it's frustrating for a pitcher. You get 3-2 count. Keep getting a piece.
Waiting back on. That's a great piece of hitting there to protect the plate.
Nice job by Aiden. I mean, with two strikes, you got to expand your strike zone as a hitter. Got to protect, and just fouling off that ball, make him keep pitching, keep frustrating him, and maybe you get the pitch that you can do something with.
Sitting on the 3-2 once again, Martel kicks and deals. Breaking ball lifted in the air to left field. Down the line, out of play, towards the bullpen.
Nice at bat here by Aiden. To Martel's credit, he's coming there, he's coming back, throwing strike after strike after strike. That's three straight foul balls here by Aiden.
And he's working, you know, all over the zone. He's not just, like, targeting one area either. He's really moving the ball around. Here we go, 3-2 again. To center, falling fast, and it's in front of Boria, who bobbles it. And kind of jogging into third base. Well, it was Fenno. He slowed up, and I think if he was going full bore, he might have been able to take the turn and come home.
So I was watching the third base coach. I was watching the third base coach there. Mm-hmm. It was a low liner, and they thought it might get caught there.
Sure.
So he was playing it safe. He kind of held him, and then once it dropped, even though there was a little bit of a bobble there, you got no outs.
True.
So with no out, maybe if there's two outs, you're sending him there, but with no outs in the meat of your lineup coming.
Yeah.
Keep him at third. Let your guys drive him in. Don't take any chances at a tough play at home.
Runners at the corners. Nobody out. Indians looking to strike here. Tie up the game. Maybe perhaps take the lead. Lackey, the number three batter in the lineup. He popped out to short. That kind of check swing in the first inning.
A lot of credit to Aiden Smith there. Three foul balls then to get a piece.
Yeah. He's taken off.
They're not going to throw through.
Smart not to, obviously, with the runner at third. So now
that's the right decision.
Mm-hmm. Two in scoring position. They concede second base. Lights on here at Paul Walsh Field.
So now if you're a pitcher, you might be a little more careful with Lackey here. You got a righty pitching to a lefty. You got 2-0 count.
Left field and in for a hit. That'll tie it up. It gets
by two runs.
Sherry. And it's 2-1 Indians. On the base hit from Lackey.
I thought he'd be a little more careful there. He was down at 2-0. So if you got a hitter's count there. You're down 2-0. You have an open base. You got the three hitter. That was definitely a big advantage for the hitter. Lackey sitting fastball, knowing that he needs to throw a strike, and takes it. He hits it the opposite way and drives in two runs. Great job by Chase Lackey right there.
Great piece of hitting for sure, but really that whole setup there, you got to give the credit to Smith as well, because his at-bat was just outstanding to get on.
That's what I was talking about before, those extra stress pitches, and they mm-hmm. wear on a pitcher. I mean, these guys aren't major leaguers. Those are tough pitches. Now Dartmouth continuing to run.
Yeah, throw not even the jumps they're getting off of Martel are just unbelievable.
I mean, it's pretty obvious Freight's game plan was to come in here and run the bases, because we did not see this the other day as much. They're aggressive on the base paths, and, I mean, the throws aren't even close.
No. So up to second is Cruz. That's in the air to left field. Sherry and Reese toward foul ground, and it lands right along the fence. Still nobody out as Cruz, the cleanup hitter and fourth batter, to step in against Martel here in the third.
Yeah, if you're the Indians, you don't know how many of these Indians are going to come. You got to keep your foot on the gas and try to get as many runs as you can, because Durfee's going to come back. You got Durfee going next inning. So get those runs right here while you have another runner in scoring position and no outs.
Waiting on it, pops straight up. Should be playable. Going to be a close play for Martel. It's into the netting and it falls.
Yeah, unfortunately for him, it hit the netting. Nice job by the catcher popping off the mask. He was there.
Martel heading back to the mound. 0-2 count to Cruz, looking for out number one here in the third. Ball gets away. Pass ball moves Lackey to third. You think back to last inning, you know, when Boria led off with that single and then got thrown out at second base. You know, Durfee did get another hit from Canberra that inning as well. And you think, wow, you could have had two on with one out. It might have been a different story at the top of this inning. And in, for the Hilltoppers, it ended up being held scoreless. That's a fly ball to right. Montilla with a really good arm.
They're not going to test him.
No. Yeah, strike to the cutoff man. So first out recorded here in the third for Durfee. And it'll bring up Donovan Burgo.
Relatively shallow there. And yeah, the outfielder coming in, all his momentum coming in. It's even though they cut it off, there was really nothing there. You don't want to push that. You got one out.
And Montilla really didn't even rear back either.
No.
So, and you can see the strength of the arm. To the windup, Martel goes. Fouled off at the plate from Burgo. It's 0-1. Burgo 0-1. Grounded out to second to end the first inning.
Big spot here for Burgo. Just put the ball in the outfield, try to get in and run. You don't even have to get a hit here. Just another run's big.
One, one.
He's bunting.
That's away. 2-1.
I was going to say it could be a good play for a bunt, but I said it last time and I was wrong. So I held back, but it's a good spot for a bunt. It's maybe a suicide squeeze coming.
Well, only the one strike on the batter, so you do have kind of one attempt at it if you really want to play it safe. You know, you rarely bunt with the two strikes. Down in the zone, good take from Burgo. 3-1.
I think they know right now Martel's he's having a little bit of a tough inning, so they're being patient with the hitters right now.
That is ball four. Some of those lower pitches were strikes earlier.
Yeah, that
but Martel struggling a bit.
That one was close.
That was very close. So a one-out walk, and Coppola at the plate. Coach Martin heading out to the mound to talk to Martel in the infield with runners at the corners.
You got first and third here. You got Coppola at bat. I mean, this is good spot for Dartmouth right now. I mean, you probably, I imagine on the next pitch, you're going to get that runner in scoring position. Courtesy runner over there, I believe, for Dartmouth. I believe that's Christian Silva running for Burgo. We talked about that the other day, the courtesy runner situation in high school.
Yeah.
Where that coach, the coach has the option of bringing another runner in there, getting some more speed, which is huge.
Sure. Yeah, so Silva at first.
Up at bat, number 21, Ryan Coppola.
And Coppola at the dish. He singled. Infield single. That's a
foul
ball.
That runner's coming, but he's coming home.
That was a foul ball.
Chase Lackey came home on that. He's out at...
I could have sworn,
out at
first of all, that Coppola got a piece of that and that that was a foul ball.
That was... Yeah, that... Nice job by Chase Lackey coming home on that. Ball trickles away.
That ball redirected before it hit the glove.
I didn't hear a tip, but it did look like it took a little
bit. That was a foul ball.
Nice job by Chase
Lackey. I'm standing by that one. That was a foul ball.
Christian Silver out at third.
3-1. The Indians do grab a third run. As they say, the ball was in play. But I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's a tough play. That was a tough play. I mean,
because we saw a couple get fouled off that, you know, hit the edge of the bat. You didn't hear the ting. You just heard
I will say I didn't see the catcher argue it. So
no, that's true.
I imagine that it looked close, but I mean the ball got away from him there, and that's a tough play.
So Coppola at the dish, 1-2, nobody on now, and a strike three called, and that ends the third frame. But a tough inning for Martell and the Hilltoppers. They now saw their lead disappear, 3-1 Indians after three. Top of the fourth inning, number five batter Alexis Montilla stepping in for Durfee. Montilla singled and drove home Durfee's only run in the first inning with a two-out base hit to right field.
So if you're Aronson, you're feeling a lot better about yourself coming into this inning.
Absolutely. Now pitching with a lead. And a healthy cut from Montilla, quickly 0-2. Dartmouth last inning with three hits, three runs to take the lead here as we hit the middle inning.
Aronson wasted one there, but a little high, and I want to come back in the strike zone with this one. Got him.
In the dirt, they'll have to throw to first. Burgo on to Lackey for the out. First strikeout of the night for Aronson. Let's take a look at the where we thought maybe the pitch was fouled off. We watched it in real time, but this is an ISO of Coppola's swing that brought home the third run.
It's like the screw film. Yeah.
Over it. You're right.
Yeah.
It certainly looked, maybe it's the angle too. You know, we're a little bit off to the side, and I think that could be part of it. But
catcher's got to catch that one. That was tough play. But
yeah, and that's not the first wild pitch and pass ball we've seen tonight as well.
How are those last place Yankees?
Oh.
Chopper
nice
in a second.
Nice play by Andrews. Oh,
good stretch at first.
Lackey with the stretch. The ump confirms.
Lackey bails him out.
That he had his foot on the bag. It's really nice to have a first baseman as tall as Lackey there.
Yeah.
Because that wasn't a great throw, but he's tall enough where he bailed him out a little bit.
Sure did. So Espinal retired for the second time in the game. Ferreira stepping up with nobody on, two down, and reached out a walk in his first plate appearance. He led off the second inning with that walk. Hard hit, chopper up the middle off the glove of Andrews, and he will not recover from it. Would have been a tough play, but kind of muffed it with the glove.
Yeah, no, tough play. He wasn't gonna make that out. Up the middle, goes to the backhand. You got at that point, once you go into the backhand and you're that deep in the hole, you either field it cleanly or you eat it.
Yeah.
Don't make that throw, take any chances of throwing that ball away.
So an infield single for Ferreira, and the Hilltoppers with two out life here. They've had a base runner in every inning. And it's Owen Moniz, the DH at the plate.
Moniz.
Off the mound. Smith will go to first and just gets it there. Strike from Smith, showing off the arm. And the side is retired, and the Indians coming up.
I'll tell you, that's a quick inning for Aronson.
Yeah.
After a few laboring innings, he came out this inning relatively, got him out with relative ease.
He needed
back,
that.
Back in the dugout pretty quickly, and then you have Martel coming out here after a really tough inning. I could see when Martel left the mound last inning, he was pretty dejected. That because he had been he had been cruising all game. He had no issues all game until that last inning. He had hit a little bit of a speed bump. So,
well, officially halfway through here as we're mid fourth at Paul Walsh Field. Martel, as you said, out there now to warm up here for his fourth inning of work. He's going to face the bottom part of the order for
last three hitters. Yeah, I mean, Dartmouth started the last inning with their lead at the top of the order, and they kind of worked their way through the order there, batting the first six guys there. So I mean, if you're Martel, you don't want to get to the top of the lineup, but you've had some issues with you haven't given up any hits to so far, so you want to keep it that way. If you're Martel, get out of this inning, get into the fifth relatively unscathed.
Yeah, LaRiviere, two fly ball outs and a strikeout to this third of the lineup, first time through. So clearly second time through for Dartmouth, though, seeing Martel has paid off because we turned the card over at the bottom of last inning, and that's where they started to make some noise. So second look has been troublesome for Martel. First pitch swinging, lofted in the air to right center field. Montilla is there. One pitch, one out. That's helpful as well.
No, that's the perfect start after a stressful inning for him last time. That's exactly what he wanted. It was a first pitch, lazy fly, let your defense help you and cut back on some of those pitches.
Louis Freitas, the third baseman, went down swinging, one of two Ks for Martel.
Yeah, he struck out on a high fastball on a 3-2 count, Louis Freitas. That Martel brought the heat on that pitch.
Swings through it.
That's what he did again there. Mm-hmm. That was a nice pitch.
1-1.
Dartmouth offense, as we've seen all day, is manufacturing runs, and once they get on base, they're running.
Yeah.
So it's
the dangerous on the bases.
A lot of pressure on the Durfee catcher today because you got a lot of movement on Martel's pitches, and you got an aggressive base runners. It's not an easy job back there.
Close pitch to take. Martel really wanted that one.
He thought he had that. He was bouncing up and down on the mound. He was hoping he had that one right there.
So 2-2 now. After the tailing fastball just outside enough to not call the strike. Same spot, but that time a breaking ball snaps a little too far, and the count is full.
Yeah, he made that easy on Louis right there because it wasn't really that close.
Not enough to entice by any stretch. Three-two pitch to Freitas. Staying alive, into the screen it goes. Yeah, I guess the screen worked for John over there on our first base camera.
As long as we keep John safe. Another 3-2 count for Louis.
There he is.
Netting
strike three. Breaking ball drops in there, and Freitas down on strikes for the second time. Two down.
I think he was hitting fastball there.
Yeah. And I would agree.
And he got the breaking ball, and he just kind of buckled. I think he was dead set on a fastball.
Marcus Andrews stepping up 0-for-1. He flew out to right field to end the second. He comes up to the plate with no on. And two down, looks at strike one.
And a nice job by Martell on that last 3-2 count to have enough confidence in yourself. Bring that breaking ball after the one before that had just snapped off way to the right.
Yeah.
Good pitch.
Strike two. Martell seems to be a new man on the hill. Attacking the zone here in the fourth, trying to pick up the first 1-2-3 inning of the night for either pitcher. 0-2 to Andrews. And he hits him.
Yep.
Off the shoulder. And a two-out base runner.
You had been calling for that 1-2-3 inning seconds before. Way to go, Evan.
I'm hearing it from both sides now. I got Andy on the right. I got you on my left. Let's pick on the Durfee guy tonight.
You're surrounded.
Oh, my gosh. All right, top of the order. And the leadoff batter, Fenno.
Fenno has seen two pitches and two at-bats. And two bats. Two and both his at-bats.
He doesn't wait around.
So I'm guessing first pitch, he's swinging.
Why not? I mean, yeah, he's 50%.
Yeah.
You know, so why not? Try your chances.
Mark Sanders, he's got some speed over there at first, and we know the Indians have been aggressive all game, so you can look for him to run here.
He's garnering some attention from Martell. Two pickoff throws over there, and Fenno takes a pitch, and it's down and away.
Well, so, I guess I was wrong.
Ball one.
Andrews took a secondary lead over there, but held back. Got two outs here, top of the order.
Yeah, see what the hitters can do, honestly. Don't get thrown out of the bases. Yeah. Although they've been very successful tonight on the bases. Low strike called to even the count, 1-1.
Martell doing the right thing right here. If I'm him, he's taking a peek. Worry about the hitter.
Here he goes. That hits the batter as well. Or no.
He just got out of the way.
Wow, I could have sworn it hit him. Ducked out of the way just in time. And another theft of a base for the Indians. As down to second goes Andrews.
Good jump by Andrews. Now you got a runner in scoring position for Fenno. 2-1 count, 3-1 now.
Good jump by Andrews. Better dance moves by Fenno to avoid that breaking ball that was coming at him.
Looking like Evan on the dance floor over there.
Wow. Wow. 3-1.
I've seen the Facebook videos.
What Facebook videos?
Can't wipe the internet completely, Evan.
Oh, yeah. No. Trust me, there's no dancing.
I don't believe it.
On walk with two down. Fenno at first. Two out base runners for the Indians. And Martell, after a strong start to this inning, running into some trouble now again. Smith now up at the plate.
He's been on base both times today.
Yep. A walk, a hit, and a run scored. The Indians looking to cash in here with a two-hour rally. That one up and in, and it's 2-0.
Fenno taking a huge lead at second base.
Martin's out to talk to Martell, go over the signs. I don't see any action in the.
With the runner at second base.
Durfee bullpen.
The runner at second base. I know pitchers and catchers do get paranoid because he can see the signs.
Yeah. 2-0. Smith takes a strike. I think Martell took a little something off there. Get me over strike. Two and one. See if Smith has the green light here or not. Check on the runner. Oh, that ball started tailing away.
Yeah, that was dangerous.
That was dangerous.
But this is where the Dartmouth being so aggressive on the base paths gets. I mean, we've seen it's had an effect on the pitcher as well, mm-hmm. where he's unable just to worry about just the batter. He's worried about the base runners because they've been so aggressive all game.
Yeah. That was fouled off at the plate. 2-2 the count now to Smith.
We got a the moon.
There's the moon.
Nice camera shot there. Moon to some nighttime baseball right here. At Paul Walsh Field.
Good piece to stay alive.
Aiden Smith is tough to get out. We saw in that last at-bat where he kept on fighting off pitch after pitch after pitch. With two strikes, he shortens up the swing. He's just looking to make contact and do some damage. He's got another opportunity here.
Upstairs. Full count. And the runners will be off with the pitch with two down.
So if he gets that ball, if with a hit here, you could score two runs, even though it's first and second, just because the runners are going to be flying. There's no holding.
Payoff pitch from Martel is going to miss.
Oh, and
gets away.
He's going to take a turn. He's coming
home. He's going to come home, throw home. It's going to be in time. They get the runner at the plate. They gambled.
That's been their MO all game.
Uh-huh.
Is putting the pressure on the defense. Even though they don't get the run there, that's in the back of their head that Dartmouth is going to run on every opportunity there. Great play by the catcher.
Done with 4-3-1 Indians from Paul Walsh Field. One and two expected here for Durfee in the top of the fifth. Ben Sherry leading off the inning for the Hilltoppers. Crazy way to end the bottom of the fourth, Chad. We had the runners in motion on the two out, 3-2 pitch with first and second.
It's not often that you see a runner try to take two bases on a pass ball.
Right.
But we were saying before, deep backstop. Dartmouth, they've been aggressive all game. That kind of stuff's going to happen.
A lot of angles here, too. You know, it's not just a flush fence. It juts in and then juts out to a corner again on either wing. So the ball was well in the corner, but Martins got to it, threw a strike to Martel, who was covering home plate, and he applied the tag to Andrews, 2-1, the putout after the walk.
Yeah, they forced the Hilltoppers to make a perfect play, and they did.
Yeah. So, but that, you know, we talk about some plays. I said earlier, you know, the hot shot liner from Espinal in the first inning that Aronson caught, right? You know, came right back at his glove, and that ended the first inning. Durfee still had two men on in that inning.
If you watch here, it takes a little bit of a tricky hop. That last hop almost gets Andrews, but does a good job staying behind it and making the play at first. That last, the edge of that infield grass can get tricky.
Mm-hmm. So Sherry retired 4-3, the putout. But, you know, looking back at that first inning, Durfee had second and third, and Espinal all but had a hit if it wasn't for Aronson's awesome defensive play, snagging it in the air. It could have easily been 3-0 Durfee after one. You know, and now you just saw a run taken away right here. That's a rope to the right side.
Nice play
Andrews.
By Andrews
had a good break to it and holds on. Another nice play. Lackey bailing out. Another tough throw.
I'll tell you what, if Lackey was 5'8 instead of 6'3, Andrews would have a couple errors today. I mean, that's a.
Andrews has been busy.
What happened there is he never set his feet. The ball carried him to first base, and he never got his feet under him. He tried to make a throw on the run, and it kind of took off on him. But nice job by Lackey. Lackey has been really solid at first base today.
Andrews has had 5 of the 14 outs so far tonight.
I'll tell you, if you look at the mostly clean uniforms, except for Andrews. Andrews, yeah. his entire uniform is covered.
So, you know, getting back to it, though, I mean, this game, you know, a couple little plays here and there have definitely had an impact in getting us to where we are right now, which is a 3-1 Dartmouth game. It could very easily be tied. It could very easily be a Durfee lead right now.
Dartmouth's had that one big inning
so
far. Other than that, Martell's been really good. He just had one inning. I mean, for the most part, both pitchers have been in command all game, except with the exception of that one inning for Martell.
I mean, Martell struggled at the end of last inning with some of the control issues again, but didn't end up coming back to hurt them, luckily. That is outside, a two-out walk. That is just the third free pass issued by Aronson. It comes here with two down. Martell, who was just, we're just talking about his pitching. Martell works the walk, so he's on base for the first time. Canberra will step up. He's got two singles tonight in the number three spot. He scored Durfee's only run back in the first. And he'll look at strike one.
If you're Durfee, you're down 3-1, top five. You got the heart of your order coming up. Ideally, you want to start putting some pressure right here.
Yeah. I mean, now you're getting into later innings here.
You don't know how many times that these guys are going to come up again, especially with the way Aronson's pitching. So you got to start putting the pressure on Dartmouth if you want to claw back in this game.
0-1 pitch. Up the middle off the mound.
Andrews
ranging, steps on the bag at second base and takes it himself.
Andrews, all three outs.
Yeah.
So he reached out for it here. The mound kind of slows it down, luckily for Andrews.
Great play.
Because it hits the mound, Andrews is easy. It slows it down enough for Andrews to make the play at second. Nice job by him. He was all over the place. Another quick inning by Aronson.
Aronson only went 5 innings in the game against Stang, but I feel like he's thrown less pitches tonight. We'll see if he comes out for the sixth.
Yeah, I'd imagine. You at least bring him out and you see what happens.
Yeah.
He's pitched so well that taking him out now probably looks like we got a new pitcher in for Durfee.
Yeah, number 15 for the Hilltoppers, Aiden Travers coming in now in relief of Martell, who went for the first 4 innings.
Lefty.
Now the lefty. Gonna come up, take the hill. So just a quick, a rough line here, unofficially, for Martell. 5 hits, 3 runs, 2 earned, 1, 2, 3, 4 walks, and 3 strikeouts.
Overall, not a bad outing for Martell. Him and Martins had a few issues with pass balls.
And I don't think Martell went anywhere else. I'm kind of scanning the field, and it looks like defensively, Durfee, nothing's changed. So Martell's day done. And I would imagine then, from a hitting standpoint, well, Martell just got on with that walk, so you have to turn the card over basically a full time before Travers would come up to, you know, bat in his place.
Dartmouth has action in the bullpen, but I do expect Aronson probably to come out, at least start the inning.
Yeah, I would think so.
Pitch count's relatively low.
All right, ready for baseball here. Bottom of the fifth inning. The Indians come to the plate. Lackey, Cruz, and Burgo, 3, 4, and 5 in the lineup. And two of them are left-handed batters, so not surprised. Coach Martin's maybe thinking ahead for Durfee.
Yeah, this
putting a lefty on the hill.
That's the part of the lineup you want to bring a left-handed pitcher. You got Lackey over here.
We'll see what Travers has to offer. First pitch missing down and away. Oh, that one missing badly in the dirt.
Lackey has one hit. He's also been great in the field today.
Swinging on the 2-0. And Lackey swings through it. Said, you know, it's getting dark in here. They turned the lights on at the stadium, and I said, hello. We didn't turn the lights on over our heads in the booth.
Take good care of us over here.
Now we can see. Well, I'm scoring the game. I kind of got to see, you know. Close pitch. Ball three.
You keep a nice scorebook. It's very neat.
I try.
Mediocre penmanship, but not too bad.
Oh, would you stop? Oh, mediocre penmanship.
Well, mine's worse.
I don't even know what I'm looking at on your book. Let's not even go there, shall we? Ball four and a leadoff walk.
You and me both. It's a mess.
Oh, boy. So Dartmouth kind of picking up offensively in Durfee pitching-wise where they left off in the fourth. Hit by pitch and two walks. That was the last three batters for Dartmouth in the fourth inning, and now they lead off the fifth inning with a free pass. So the runner at first, Lackey, and Cruz, the cleanup hitter, takes strike one.
We've seen it all game. We know Dartmouth on the base paths. You can and now they have now a different look for the base runners with the left-handed pitcher, and that's another reason that can't hurt with this pitching change. Getting the lefty might slow down the Dartmouth base runners.
Yeah, perhaps.
Oh, he's gone.
Swinging through the pitch and the throw late and into center field. So Lackey with the stolen base and on to third on the throwing error.
Great job by Lackey there. I mean, honestly, he had the throw beaten pretty easily.
Yeah.
And then late throw and then to get third on top of it. Dartmouth all game has made the Hilltoppers press on the with their base running. So, I mean, Coach Mike Freitz, he's aggressive.
Into the screen it goes, a foul ball, and it is 0-2.
I mean, being aggressive on the base pass puts pressure on everyone, puts pressure on their pitcher, the catcher's more. You got all the fielders having to think about it. It's if you have a fast team, it's a big, big advantage.
And the infield comes in. They're playing at the tip of the grass with the runner at third. Pokes right back where it came from. Infield's in or back. They weren't getting to that one. An RBI single for Cruz, and it's 4-1 Indians.
Big hit there by Cruz.
Good piece of hitting.
It was almost like a half swing, kind of reached out for it, put it right up the middle. Nice job.
So Travers not greeted very friendly here by the Indians. They work the walk, they run the bases, and Cruz delivers with the base hit.
Looks like Dartmouth made a sub here.
Number 5 for the Indians.
Madden Olila.
Yeah, Olila started.
Saw him the other day.
Yeah, he was in the starting 9 on Friday. And he's now pinch hitting for Burgo. Oh, and you know what?
Take out the lefty.
I was just going to say the pitching change sparked
now
that.
For Dartmouth, number 5, Madden Olila.
So this is the part of the game where you see the managers kind of starting to play different matchups.
I mean, it's still a close game, despite the fact that Dartmouth just tacked on their fourth run. It's only a 3-run game. So this is not a blowout by any stretch. That's in the air. Down the right field, and that is in the corner. Down the line, Mantilla.
Maybe not.
Going after it, and it is two bases.
Nice.
Pinch hit.
Inside out swing right there by Olila.
Pinch hit double for Olila on the first pitch he sees. And it's second and third, nobody out.
He's been sitting on the bench all game. You come in, you make an immediate impact on the first pitch. Good for him. Nice piece of hitting.
Coppola the batter, one for two, a base hit, and a strikeout.
Dartmouth threatening again. You got two guys, you got runners in scoring position, no outs.
Chopper at the plate. You saw the movement on that breaking ball.
Yeah, he fought it off. That was a good pitch.
The base hit for Coppola was an infield single, the one that was to deep short in the hole. He beat it out.
To Aspinall, yep.
And he struck out looking to end the third. So one for two, and down in the count 0-1. Make it 0-2 as he swings over that one. I like the call. You know, Travers going right back to the breaking ball. Kind of had him on his toes at the first pitch. Why not try it again? And that time swings over it, and now he's ahead 0-2.
Yeah, because if you're Coppola, you're just trying to put that ball in the outfield. A fly ball scores a run right here.
Yep, infield in again, trying to backdoor him, and it misses outside, and it's 1-2.
That didn't miss by much.
No.
It was a good pitch, especially with an 0-2 count. That's a good pitch right there. Infield in again.
Yep.
At least
that misses.
Pinched in the middle, yeah. Heavy run big right here, so right. A grounder to third. He'll be checking the runner, trying to hold the runner at third, and then before he throws to first.
Cruz at third. Olila at second. And that's a balk. That's a run. 5-1, Dartmouth on the balk.
But again, that's the Dartmouth base running all game. I know they got a run thrown out last inning at home.
Yeah.
But that's what being in the opponent's head is. It's constantly that pitcher having to think about it. Yeah, that was a pretty blatant balk right there.
Yeah. So each runner advances. Chopper to short. Espinal plays Ferreira. The in-between hop, and Ferreira can't squeeze the glove on Durfee's.
He's running. He's at third.
He's going to third. He's going to be just in there. Durfee's second error of the inning.
Good job taking off out of the box here. Again, run it out, see what happens. Run hard to first. Makes the error, takes a hard turn, quick turn at
now
second.
Eight,
he's at third. Now we have another runner at third, even after scoring a run. Great job.
The throw just kind of died. It was a strong throw, but a short throw, and it just bounced. So Coppola at third on the E6.
Big inning for the Indians here. You guys still have no outs. Runner on third. Just what they needed. Double their lead.
Flare to left. Falling fast into the glove of Sherry. They're not going to test it as that ball only made it to shallow left. So out number one. And that's the second time LaRivière has flown out to left field. He's had three fly ball outs in the game.
Yeah, that's a big out. Just get that first out of the inning.
And this is where the bottom of the lineup, as you said last time, has really been the one spot that Durfee has had
pitching.
Yeah, they've had pitching success. No hits. Scooped at third. Good throw. The runner comes in the back door. It's a four-run fifth inning for Dartmouth so far. And now two down after the ground out. And we'll go to Andrews, the number 9 batter.
Okay.
Yeah. Nice play at third. Yeah, we got a fire over there. Some black smoke. That's Not great. Imagine we'll be hearing sirens shortly. Base is clear. Two outs.
A scary situation behind the football stadium. We're seeing a fire. I'm not sure if it's a car or if it's a building. It really went up fast, and a lot of times it's a car. But kind of a scary situation here at the other end of the facility.
Yeah, we're starting to see the smoke head our way with the wind.
Yeah.
There is.
Oh, yeah, there is. I can see that the...
We do have emergency vehicles there, so...
Well, I mean, the police department's not... It's right around the corner, you know. But
you can see, yeah, you're starting to get a whiff of it over here.
Wow, that's crazy.
Hilltopper's looking to get out of this inning right now.
That is strike three called, and they are out of it as Andrews goes down. Looking, and that's the end of the fifth inning, but another tough inning for Durfee. They give up four runs, 7-1 after five. Top six from Paul Walsh Field, Evan Massoud, and Chad Amaral with you for live baseball. If you're wondering, we just got back to the field, but the fire trucks now have made it to the fire there on the side street behind the football stadium. It's not Parker Street. I forget which street that is. That is... Maxfield Street, that's right. So they're tending to the emergency situation here. Pitching change for the Indians. Aronson's day is done, or night is done. Ian Rigo, number 14, has taken to the mound. Another tall righty for Coach Freights. And with the 7-1 lead, I would imagine he will look to go on these final two innings and finish off the game.
Yeah, we saw another guy the other day. Throws hard. Another big, tall righty for Dartmouth. More of the same if you're the Hilltoppers here. it's not much of a drop-off between Aarons and Rigo. Yet another tough pitcher.
Well, Reese will get on base for the second time via a walk, so he's been on twice without the benefit of a hit. And so the leadoff man on for the Hilltoppers for the first time since the second inning. So maybe this will get something going for Durfee as Montilla steps in once again, a one-for-two day.
He's driven in the only run for the Hilltoppers so far.
The line for Aaronson, unofficially five hits, one run in five innings. He walked three batters and struck out one. That's a roll and a short. 6-4 and not going to get him at first. So Montilla reaching on the fielder's choice.
Nice job by Aiden. But the ball died a little bit in the infield. Turned Montilla with a little bit, was showing some speed. Hard double play to turn, but yeah. Nice job. Looks like the fire is out.
Yep, the white smoke is the signal. So that's a good thing. So Montilla now at first base. And Espinal the batter, 0-for-2. Line out and a ground out. And they check on Montilla.
The 7-1 game, I imagine, probably not going to be too aggressive on the base paths. You got to claw back now. Now it's
there's no
6-run solution. You got to get one run back at a time.
Yeah, you got to put together quality at bats. Try to string some hits together
and grind out 6 runs. Not impossible at all.
That wild pitch will move Montilla up to second. Takes a wide turn, and now we'll head back to second base.
A little bit of a hop on him there. Off-speed pitch in the dirt. Tough play on a catcher.
1-2 to Espinal. Rope to left. In for a hit. Montilla running on contact, and he will run down the line. Strong throw home is not in time. And the Hilltoppers have their second run. They get one back. Montilla scores from second on the RBI. Single from Espinal.
He played it cleanly, but Montilla had a good jump. Nice throw. They held the cutoff, but he was a few steps ahead of it. Not quite a tight play at the plate.
Now batting
nice,
number 16,
nice job.
Aaron Ferreira.
Aaron Ferreira at the plate has not been retired tonight in the seventh spot. Walked in the second, was erased on a double play, and then had an infield single in the fourth. Was stranded there. So 7-2 now, and Coach Freight's coming out with the count 0-1, coming to talk to the pitcher.
Yeah, if you're just trying to settle him in. I mean, he came into the game, he's had it's a cold night. Just settle him in and just right now just take each batter. You got 5 outs left as a pitcher.
Right.
One at a time, get through right here. You got the bottom of the order. So you want to pay extra close attention. You don't want to face the top of the order. Get these last 2 outs in this bottom four of the order. And
no, you're right. I mean, you got the cushion. It's a 5-run game. It's not like, you know, if Dartmouth hadn't just gotten 4 runs, now it's 3-2, I'd be more concerned. But, you know, you just had a big 4-run fifth inning. You've got some breathing room. 7-2 score. Attack the hitter. Don't worry about the runner at first. Driven in the air, deep to right. Cruz heading back at the wall, off the fence. Almost got out of here, right where the double fence begins.
That ball was stung. That ball was crushed. But didn't score a run.
I know, can you believe that?
Maybe he was watching it like we were. That was absolutely crushed.
Hardest hit ball of the night. Ferreira getting around on one here. Here's the replay. Oh, it didn't actually hit the fence. It looked like it did. Landed right shy of the warning track, but still, that's a bomb. And, you know, it's such a big field, you don't always get the ball hit out there so much. You could argue that the outfielders are playing a bit in for Dartmouth. They have been all game. They kind of, medium to shallow depth.
In right field, I think that's probably the first ball that's been hit out there all day.
Yeah.
And it had him twisting and turning. I mean, he definitely didn't have a great read on it.
No.
Because his first step was right, and it took him back the other way. So, tough play. But that ball, it was great hitting. I mean, now, if you're Hilltoppers, you got to capitalize here.
Absolutely. One out,
two runners in scoring position. If you want to get back in this game, now's the time.
Ripped to left and going foul, hooking. Out of bounds, out of play. Mona's the batter, 0 for 2. Two ground outs. Espinal at third. So Ferreira at second after the double.
So if you're Rigo here, this is a big at bat. Get this out.
Good piece there to stay alive. That's a tough pitch to foul off.
Absolutely.
Breaking ball, jamming you inside with two strikes. Mona's up there protecting.
Dartmouth still playing back.
They're willing to concede one run.
Infield at normal depth.
Struck him out. Two down.
Big strikeout right there for Ego.
Yeah.
You can take a deep breath. Now you got two outs.
And Sherry, the batter, 0 for 2. Ball one in the dirt.
Rigo, one of the few people on Dartmouth actually going long sleeves. Mm. Everyone else has the short sleeves. He's cold like you.
One and one. If the inning continues, Boria, the leadoff man, on deck. Rigo trying to avoid that situation. That's in the dirt as well. Nice block.
Another breaking ball.
Yeah, good block to protect there and keep it in front of you.
It's dangerous to be throwing breaking balls right now with second and third.
Outside, 3-1, close pitch.
Get that ball in the dirt, gets by the catcher, run scoring. So you got to be careful with that breaking ball, and you really have to be on the same page with your catcher. So he knows the breaking ball's coming. You don't want to cross him up now.
Chopper to the third baseman. Nice scoop by Freitas to throw in time. And the Indians escape further trouble here in the sixth. Durfee grabs a run, but it could have been worse.
Nice job by Louis charging this ball. Knows it's going to be tough play, charges it. Puts all his weight behind the throw. He knew right away as soon as he let go of that ball, he had the out.
Durfee's offense coming alive a little bit. Couple of hits and a run, but still a lot of work to do.
That's two big outs for Rigo. That inning could have gotten away from him, and to settle in right there, make those outs, keep the lead to 5.
And back out on the hill for Durfee. Travers coming back out here in the sixth inning.
We got the top of the order for the Indians coming up.
Next Friday, the 12th, is the next time we have live action, live sports here on DCTV. Softball from the Quinn Elementary School as the Lady Indians host the Lady Whalers from New Bedford, from right here. That's next Friday.
Tell me, we had the softball game the other day. That really, really impressed with them. They beat North Attleboro pretty handily, and North Attleboro had a really good team.
Yeah, Coach Arguin and her girls are always primed and ready. They are solid. That'll be actually a rematch, by the way, from April 26th, and it was the Indians suffering a 4-1 loss to New Bedford in that game, so they'll be looking for some revenge in conference play. Here we go. Bottom of the sixth underway, and it's ball one.
For Travers, you're looking to settle in here. Tough first inning for him. Now settle in and give your team a chance to get back in this game.
The leadoff batter, Chase Fenno, at the dish for the fourth time in the game. Now 1-1 as he looks at a breaking ball. Flew out to center, singled to center, and scored, walked, and was left at second in his three plate appearances. Got a stolen base mixed in there as well. Waves at that one, diving at the breaking ball, and it's 1-2. Yeah, 1-6 in the order has been a challenge for Durfee pitching tonight.
Yeah, this part of the order has been definitely lit the fire for the Indians today.
That one in the dirt. Two and two. Two, two. Great piece of hitting from Fenno. Finds the outfield grass, slicing it, just getting a piece.
Nice job by Chase.
And he's on base for the third time.
Taking it the other way.
Protecting with two outs, taking what you're given.
The top of the order has been relentless all game.
Speaking of relentless, Aiden Smith.
Number three, Aiden Smith.
He's been on all three times. Two walks, a single.
He's seen like 25 pitches just by himself. He's been full counts, fouling balls off all game. He's been a pest for the pitchers.
Oh, some good alliteration right there. Pest for the pitchers.
I try. Still learning, you know. One day, I'll be up to your standards, Evan.
Oh, boy. Wow. Thank you.
That won't be today. That day's not today, right?
If I'm
Fenno's off.
Hey, they got him caught in the rundown, and the ball gets away.
And that's Dartmouth is.
That's what aggressive running, base running will do. It gets all, in your head.
All over the
and it forces mistakes. You had him in the rundown. You actually got him.
Yeah.
And a bad. It was a good throw. It was actually Ferreira who just didn't watch it into the glove. Oh, that's frustrating.
Dartmouth's forcing the Hilltoppers into some tough plays, and they're making the mistakes. And Dartmouth's capitalizing it.
So now, instead of a runner at first and one out and nobody out, you have a runner at third and nobody out. And Smith down in the count 0-2 after taking a pitch. Infield comes in again for Durfee.
We've seen Smith all day with two strikes, fighting pitches off.
Got him swinging. Foul tipped it into the mitt. And for the first time tonight, Smith is retired. Goes down swinging on the inside pitch.
Number 12, Chase Lackey.
Chase Lackey, the batter now. He, too, has had a tremendous game. Popped out to the shortstop in the first, but since then, a base hit, stolen base, and a run scored, and then a walk, a stolen base, and a run scored. So he's come around the bases twice tonight. The only player to score twice in the game.
Lackey's done it on both ends. He's played great defense. He's been great at the plate.
Sure. Yeah, defensively too. He has had a great night at first base. He's had to make some tough plays. Travers being asked to hold here with the runner 90 feet away at third. In the left field, this will most likely score him.
Yep.
Sherry makes the snag. It's a great play to throw home, not in time. But good ranging play from Sherry.
See, it wasn't it's not that it was hit very deep, mm-hmm. but it got him going left, so you can't set your feet. So it's not like it was hit right to him. So he goes right. left, can't really set his feet, and then it's a tough play at the plate. He's not going to get him out like that.
Yeah, all about placement there. Did the job, the sack fly, and the RBI.
The only way the outfielder is getting him there is if he can get his weight underneath him, make a clean throw home. But that was tough, ranging to your left.
That's also Lackey's second RBI of the game because his single in the first brought home a run. That one off the mound, and it rolls into center. And the hits keep coming. Cruz on base for the third time, his third hit, 3-for-4.
Nice job by Cruz. Hits it right up the middle. He's done that a couple times today where he has a patient approach, good swing. He attacks the baseball, hits it right up the middle. Nice job by him. Burgo back in the game.
Yeah, I don't understand that rule change. I find it very strange that you can pinch hit for somebody and then the other player can re-enter. I get it if you have a courtesy runner, but I think it's kind of strange that you can bring in another hitter to work a lefty-righty matchup, and then the starter that the player you just replaced can come right back in. That's very strange to me.
It's a little confusing, but
yeah,
if for the managers, it's got to be helpful to be able to do that.
No kidding.
Keep on flipping them.
If they could do that in the majors, you wouldn't have these matchups that we're talking about.
And I mean, for Freights, I mean, Madden Alila came in and actually did really well. So now he goes
did.
Back to Burgo.
Burgle in the hole, 0-2, and he just stays alive as that is fouled off. Eight to two the score. The Indians. Up by six. It's their largest advantage of the game.
Indians looking to tack on a couple more runs for the bottom of the inning. Tell you, their offense really came alive late in this game. I mean, early on, bats came off. They were a little quiet early on, and then once they got to Martell, they haven't really stopped.
That first time through the order, Martell had his way. A couple base runners scattered. But second and third time through the order, not the same story. And interestingly enough, again, similar to Friday, a few early issues for Aronson, but then he settled down and really never a threat.
He's in line for his fourth win of the season. Mm-hmm. Dartmouth late, looking to make it five straight wins with a win here tonight. They're three outs away.
Burgo putting on a good at-bat, was down 0-2. Fouled off that last pitch, worked the count now to 1-2. Travers trying to end the inning. It's a bouncer taking off for second, and they'll eat the throw.
Probably the best decision there. The ball's in the dirt. No chance of getting the base runner.
Cruz taking off as soon as he saw that it hit the dirt, so the wild pitch advancing the runner.
Yeah, it hit the dirt, bounced in front of him. It wasn't a clean play. He had no throw. Great decision not to make that throw. Can't force something that's not there.
2-2. Slow roller up the third baseline, and it goes foul. And we'll do it again. Burgo back to the box. Coming up on 8:30, this game just about 2 hours old. It was cruising until the offense kicked in gear in the middle innings. Long night here at the park. For high school ball, that is. waiting back on it. Out to left, Sherry redirects. He able to track it and make the play, but a nice piece there to for Burgo to actually get the bat on it. Good at bat, but he is retired, and we expect that that'll be the end of the night for Dartmouth's offense. We head to the seventh. Indians closing in on their fifth straight win. Back at Paul Walsh Field as the Indians and Rigo getting ready to wrap up a nighttime victory here against Durfee, up by 6 runs, 8-2 advantage. Difficult for even the best to overcome. Durfee's got a lot of work to do if they want to come back. The offense has not been that prolific tonight. We know it has been a struggle for Durfee. This season, they did have a good win on Monday, a low-scoring game against New Bedford right here, but tonight giving up 8 runs through the first 6.
If you're Dartmouth, you've played some. This has been a tough part of your schedule. You had New Bedford, you Stang, Brockton, Durfee, and to walk out of that with force with continuing your 5-game win streak is really impressive.
Yeah, it sure is, and you know that winning streak started. With non-conference play, it started against Silver Lake, and Silver Lake is no slouch when it comes to baseball here. So Silver Lake was the first win, 10-7 on the on the road.
Well, I know Mike Freight, Coach Freight said early on it was win one, lose one, win one, lose one. Mm-hmm. So they've really hit their stride as of late.
And Boria on.
And a big part of that's been Aronson, who we saw here tonight have throw another gem.
I was looking down and marking the end of last inning. Was that a walk or a hit by pitch for Boria? You walk him?
He walked.
He walked him, yeah. Okay. So Boria at first, leadoff man on for Durfee. Swinging away on the 0-1 is Travers in his first at-bat of the night since he came in to replace Martell. And he is down 0-2. Good piece, fouled and out of play.
Fiorigo, keep pounding strikes on. You got an 8-2 lead, throw strikes. Dartmouth defense has also played really, really well today.
Yeah, they have. Don't mess around. Don't even worry about Boria. Just pitch to the batter. I mean, really. The pitching has been solid tonight, and the defense has been solid tonight. And so don't change anything just because the leadoff man is on. Oh, if he scores, you still got a 5-run lead.
Yeah.
You know? So don't be too cute with it here. Just get her done.
It's a great feeling as a pitcher to know you have a good defense behind you. You don't have to go out and do it yourself. You can pitch to contact. You don't have to strike out every batter. And the way this Dartmouth defense is played, I mean, the pitchers have to feel nothing but confident.
Sure. With them behind you. Absolutely. Boria starts and stops. It is ball 2. 2-2 the count. to Travers, who was down 0-2. Upstairs, 3-2.
You don't want to lose him. You get him down 0-2.
That you don't want to do. As Canberra's been on twice tonight, and he's on deck.
I'm guessing he's just coming fastball here. Batter knows that he knows it. Don't get cute. Just throw the fastball. Fastball.
Upstairs. High. Misses. Back-to-back walks to start the inning. The first two reach for Durfee here in the seventh.
Up at bat for Durfee, number 7, Ethan Canberra.
Tough part of the order for Durfee, for Rigo. Canberra's played had himself a decent game.
He almost had a single in his last at bat. That was the play up the middle that Andrew snagged and stepped on the bag for the force. But had there not been a runner on first with a righty at the dish, that ball probably gets through. But Andrews was playing closer to second to cover, and he was able to make that play. 0-2 quickly to Canberra.
We saw 0-2 on the last batter. This one, you probably you're not going to waste too many pitches at this point. Throw strikes. It's not about getting the strikeout here. It's about just getting the out.
Upstairs. Another miss up in the zone.
Bergo coming in to talk to him. The runner on second. Just going over the signs. Don't want to get crossed up.
Well, next up for baseball, they have Old Rochester tomorrow, and then Monday, Aponequit. So two road games in a row before coming back home next Wednesday to face off against BR, which starts that second round of conference games. And for Durfee, let's just get their schedule back up here for a moment. Hilltoppers will continue. That's going to hit the batter. And the bases are going to be loaded with nobody out here in the seventh. Unbelievable.
So if you're Coach Mike Freitz, you don't want to go into your bullpen. You have no one warming up right now.
Yeah.
You don't want to make any pitching changes.
Reese.
You want to Reese go, is a dangerous bat.
Especially with a game tomorrow.
Yeah. So for Durfee, they have Stang tomorrow, Middleborough next Tuesday. Reese gives it a ride, tailing away from the center fielder. Nice running play by Fenno.
Nice play.
Runner comes home, throw to third, not in time. He stays on the bag.
He's out.
No, he's safe.
Ooh, it looked like he took his hand off the base. I know he beat the throw, but then he took his hand off the bag. Great job by Fenno. That's a huge catch.
Big running play right there.
Nice job. Hayden Smith gets the cutoff. Ooh, he almost took his hand off the bat.
Yes, he did.
Nice job holding the tag there because he went to get up and you got to call timeout. Before you get off that bag, I'm sure the third base coach is yelling at him, call timeout.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't, and he was almost the last out of the second out of the inning. Big out by Fenno.
Big time out. Just to recap here, so Stang tomorrow for Durfee at Bishop Stang as Montilla steps in here, takes a strike. Middleborough next Tuesday, next Wednesday at Somerset, and then next Thursday, BR. So that's what's up next for the Hilltoppers. 8-3 the score. Runners at the corners, one down here in the seventh. Rowdy crowd. It's gotten loud here over the last the last full frame. Rowdy in a sense of cheering, trying to get get behind the Indians here in a pressure spot.
The Indians have a loud bench. They're
yeah.
They're always watching the runner. They're always telling their pitcher where he's going.
Well, that's good. You should be watching the game. If you're not in it, you should be cheering on everybody else.
Good way to stay warm. Scream.
Is that why football fans are loud?
Yeah.
In the air in a deep left field.
He doesn't.
Coppola heading back at the wall. It's gone! Three-run home run for Montilla, and it's a two-run game.
He ran out of real estate there.
Oh, he gave that a ride. And there's no wind right now. That was pure strength from the Durfee right fielder.
Yeah, and that was absolutely crushed. That ball was hit probably 330, 335.
Yeah.
It's 320 down the line. That was just to the right.
Absolute bomb. Right in front of the scoreboard.
I thought for a while he had it, and he just ran out of space.
Wow.
Coppola did everything he could to get after it, but, yeah, a little too much there.
So those walks and the hit batter coming back to bite Dartmouth. Three passes will do you in many cases.
We got ourselves a game right
here. We got ourselves a game.
8-6.
And, again, I go back to some of the plays earlier, and particularly the line out to Aronson in the first that would have played it two more runs. It was such a great defensive play.
Indians now the Hilltoppers are feeling it. You see them dancing. They're excited now. I mean, they're battling back. We came into this inning 8-2. We already put four runs on the board. Two more, and you got yourself a tie game. So. Now we see that almost out at third.
Yeah, seriously. That's been all the batter with nobody on. One out, takes ball one upstairs. Oh, excuse me, we have a pinch hitter, my bad. Yandel Pichardo into pinch hit for Espinal, number six. And it's 1-1.
So if you're Rigo, this went from low stress to high stress real quickly.
Very quickly.
You came in this inning, six-run lead, feeling pretty good about it. Now every pitch means something. Now it's attack the batters.
Steps out. Granted time by our home plate umpire.
That's a big out.
Big time out. A lot of spin on that ball. Lackey handles it himself.
And if you're
two down in the seventh.
This out's big for a million reasons. It's the second out of the inning, but it gives Irigo some confidence. He was kind of feeling it there. I mean, to give up that home run, now settle in. You got that. Now you just one more out.
Aaron Ferreira has been on all three times tonight. And he comes up now with two down. The base is empty. Last chance for the Hilltoppers. Ball one misses just low in the zone.
Coach
Looked Freight, like he had plenty of the
Coach
plate.
Coach Freight's showing a lot of confidence in Rigo right here. Where he got him. He's saying, fight your way out of this jam and this game.
2-0. Into the screen here, the backstop.
The Hilltoppers bench is loud now.
Well, yeah.
I hadn't heard them for a couple innings, but now they are fired up.
This in, it hit the batter before the swing or on the swing. Coach Martin immediately down the line. Catcher's interference.
He's saying he hit Burgos' glove on the swing.
Let's see. Coach Freight's coming out. We'll take a look. ISO'd here in slow-mo. Watch the glove. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You saw look at Burgos duck his hand back. I think that might have hurt a little bit too.
I mean, good job by the coaches. I mean, they didn't have the benefit of slow motion replay over.
No.
Good job. Gets that. So the tying run is now at the plate. Coach Freight's now talking to the umpire himself. Pencil on the air. He's not happy.
No. The only good news, really, I guess, if you're Dartmouth, Mona's at the plate. It's had a tough night, 0-3. Two groundouts and a strikeout. That strikeout coming last time. It's Swings through the first pitch.
So if Rigo here, worry about the batter. That run doesn't...
Strike two.
Got two. One strike away. Attack the batter. End this game. Tough spot for a hitter. Down 0-2 right here. Last out.
Outside. Let's it go. Let's that one go too. Kind of like a cutter there. That's got a little bit of break to it. Not a straight fastball. And both of those missing away. 2-2.
Just judging by his grip there, he's coming fastball. Fastball.
Makes contact over the backstop and into the bleachers. Staying alive.
If you're Rigo, you got the bottom of the order here. You have pretty good speed on your fastball. Bring it.
2-2 again. Down low, just missing. And the count is full. Crowd not happy.
You can see Rigo, his shoulders, he's slumping a little bit. Like,
what a great at-bat, though, right now from...
Battled his way back.
Yeah.
Oh, down 0-2. Now he got a 3-2 count.
Payoff pitch. Upstairs, he lost him. Tying run on base. That is the third walk of the inning. And now Ben Sherry, the batter. 0-3.
Up at bat for the Hilltoppers.
Fly ball to left. Ground out to second. Ground out to third. Durfee's last hope. Swings through the first. He was late on it.
You can see some frustration in Dartmouth. They thought they had some calls there that they didn't get. And now this is a tight one right here. Yeah. Winning run. Well,
strike two.
Tie and run at first. Big pitches right here.
As you said, taxing, stressful pitches.
Yes. 0-2.
0-2. Same spot you just had Mona's. 0-2 to Sherry. Swings through it for strike three. And Rigo and the Indians hang on, but it wasn't pretty. What a rally from Durfee. As he almost pulled off the comeback.
Yeah, Dartmouth had the game in hand, but Durfee battled back. Big home run. We had a home run for Durfee in the inning, and the Hilltoppers did not go away easy. Dartmouth had to earn the victory, especially in that last inning. Hard-fought game by both teams. I think both managers walk away saying their teams played really well.
They sent 9 men to the plate here in the 7th inning, Durfee did. The... go-ahead run at the plate, and Sherry strikes out to end it. But, man, what a wild ending to this one here. And Dartmouth does end up holding on to that, to what is now their 5th straight victory, continuing to do well in conference play. And 8-6, the final score, as Durfee goes back in the loss column.
Dartmouth
now at 4-6 on the season, and Dartmouth
sprint.
At 7-3 as they cool down in the outfield. What a fun one tonight! Thought last week was fun. This was a wild finish.
No, the game Dartmouth. I thought Dartmouth had it won 2 innings ago, but nope. Good job by the Hilltoppers. They showed a lot of fight, and we had ourselves a great game. Very interesting last bottom of the 7th there. Top of the 7th, sorry.
Well, I'm glad we got this one in. Folks, thanks for tuning in tonight for our live baseball coverage for our great crew behind the scenes. My broadcast partner again, Chad Amaral. I'm Evan Massoud. Tune in next Friday, May the 12th, for softball as the Lady Indians host the Lady Whalers from the Quinn Elementary School. Enjoy the rest of your week, folks. Good night.